Directo a la Comunidad on BCTV is supported by UPMC for you.
Buenos días, mi nombre es Hector Dorta, muchos de ustedes me conocen como Junior el Zarcero. Este es mi programa Directo a la Comunidad, que es cada segundo miércoles del mes, de 6:30 a 7, pero tenemos una edición especial hoy. Tiene que ver con una enfermedad que está escondida, para mí escondida la enfermedad. Y pues hoy es viernes, noviembre 16, 2018, son las 10:30 de la mañana. El programa es vivo hasta las 11, se pueden comunicar con nosotros, me pueden llamar en vivo y hacer preguntas al 610-378-0426. Buenos días. Good morning. My name is Hector Dorta. This is Direct to the Community. It's a program that's every second Wednesday of the month from 6:37. But today our program, it's a special, and it is Friday, November 16th, and I'm going to be with you till 11 o'clock. If you wish to call and ask questions, you can. It's a live program. 610-378-0426, and we'd be glad to answer some questions. Well, I have a great guest today. This has been anticipated for a long time. Yeah. We should have had this a long time ago, but I'd like to welcome you to my show.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here.
Thank you. Can we get your name?
Of course. I am Anne Desjardins.
And I was going to say it at first, but I'm afraid that I'm going to mess up the last name.
I think you'd be the first one, so okay. It's no big deal.
You are the manager of the Berks County Lyme Support Group.
Correct.
A regional of PA Lyme.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And we're talking about Lyme disease.
Yes.
A lot of people, we've been talking in the back, we've talked for several weeks. Let's just start with the first question. What is Lyme disease?
Okay, so Lyme disease is a bacterial infection that you would get from a tick bite. So ticks are in our environment everywhere. They're mm-hmm. sometimes in the woods, sometimes in our own backyard, on a park bench, on a mm-hmm. stone wall. They're found everywhere in nature, outside. And it is a pretty horrible illness that you can mm-hmm. contract if you do happen to have the misfortune of being bit by a tick.
Okay. Le pregunté a la señorita, and ¿qué es el Lyme disease? El Lyme disease es un garrapata. El garrapata es bien pequeñito. Vamos a hablar sobre eso. Tan pequeñito que es como la punta de una aguja. La enfermedad que viene con esto, una enfermedad crónica, es un virus que entra a tu cuerpo y hace mucho daño. Y vamos a hablar sobre eso, porque la razón de este programa hoy es para educar a usted de la comunidad latina, porque esto es algo que existe en nuestra comunidad. Hay personas que lo tienen y no lo saben que lo tienen. Y por esto es que este programa de hoy es bien, bien importante. How do you get Lyme disease?
Again, getting bit by a tick. So when a tick is born, it doesn't actually have Lyme disease.
Okay.
It has to have a blood meal to contract it. So typically that comes out of the small rodent population. A tick will bite its first meal on a mouse or a chipmunk or something.
Okay.
And then it contracts the Lyme. And a lot of times, unfortunately, it will contract other co-infections at the same time that it would have other illnesses it could potentially give to you. But then when it goes through its life cycle, there's four different life stages for a mm-hmm. tick. And each time it transfers into the next phase, it needs a blood meal. So then when it's a nymph, that's the second stage. It's the smallest, tiniest thing, like a grain of sand.
Pin, the top of a pin.
Yep, like a poppy seed, very small. And then it looks for a blood meal to turn into its next stage. And they're very active in the springtime in particular. So then that's why they're so hard to find, because they're so small. They also secrete a numbing agent when they bite you, so you don't feel them. Correct.
Le hice la pregunta que cómo usted puede recibir el Lyme disease, cómo usted puede coger la infección. Y ella dice que hay dos niveles. El primero es la garrapata, que nace pequeñita, pica un animal como un ratón, una rata, diferentes animales que se consiguen en el Vasco, en nuestra comunidad. La segunda es que vuelve y pica otra vez, y ahí es que coge la enfermedad. No solamente el Lyme disease, hay posibilidades que coja muchas infecciones bacterias que le puede dar a ustedes. What are the symptoms of Lyme disease? And this is the one that I really, because when we talked several months ago, we talked and I asked, and then you said, Hector, look it up. And I looked up and there are so many symptoms. We were just talking. I know my daughter's watching in Boston, Alicia, and I told her that she has lupus, and she's. But at the same time, you said she should be tested for Lyme disease.
Yes.
And maybe she's getting this information now because I don't have to call her later.
Yeah.
She should get tested for Lyme disease. I mean, it's
yes,
just.
Please.
What are the symptoms? There's a lot of them. How can somebody say, okay, you know what, I think this is Lyme disease, let me go check? Or do you suggest that if you have one of the symptoms, we talked about the price, let's.
Sure.
Okay.
So, you know, Lyme has potentially over 100 symptoms. And that is part of the problem. It's called the great imitator. It looks like a lot of other diseases. There's been potential research going on that shows that a lot of the autoimmune disorders that people are having are potentially maybe generated through Lyme, and then it stems out into other things. Where my understanding is, like MS, for example, has lesions on your spinal column, but that's what Lyme will do to you as well. So maybe a lot of MS patients really have Lyme. Even Alzheimer's. They show a lot of people that have Alzheimer's, when they pass away, they do their autopsy, they find Lyme bacteria in their brain. So that's the problem, is that it looks like so many other things. Main problems. Initially, when you get bit, generally people think you're going to get a bullseye rash. All right. That only occurs in less than 50% of people that you get the rash.
But how many, 20%?
Less than 50.
Less than 50.
Right.
Okay.
And then you would also get, a lot of people would have more like a summer flu symptoms, where you might have a lot of fever, fatigue, sweats, chills, body aches. You just feel off. And so that could be an indicator as well. And if you catch Lyme initially, you're in a much better position to recover fully easily with the recommended course of 3 to 4 weeks of antibiotics, if you're aware of it. If you have the misfortune of not finding a tick bite or remembering a tick bite you, then potentially you're going to go for a longer period of time without them understanding what's wrong with you. I know personally on my own journey, I was screened for everything under the sun, I promise.
They couldn't find nothing.
And they never checked me for Lyme, which it's okay. That's part of my mission, is to educate people that this is something to consider. But like, I had horrible fatigue. I had night sweats, neck creaking, like my neck would crack a lot. I had 2 heart fluttering episodes. I started to lose the hearing in my left ear. I had a lot of dizziness towards the end. So initially for me, it was fatigue and like getting words to come out right, remembering the words to make them come out. I would stutter sometimes. I had a little bit of a numbness in the left side of my face. Just having a conversation like we're having now would be very difficult for me. I mean, I have to wait for you to talk to me to be able to talk back to you, because I couldn't remember what we were talking about to answer you. So there's a lot of energy going on in making things look like they're fine.
Right.
But it is, it's almost like zombie zone. Like the lights are on, but nobody's home. And then the fatigue was crippling. But towards the end, these other weird symptoms started to happen. And I mean, I couldn't even get a screw to go through a hole when I was putting together a new grill. I had zero coordination.
No coordination.
I'd walk my dog for 4 miles a day. I couldn't even go for 4 blocks basically without feeling like I was going to fall over. So there's tons. I had hives. I read that's a symptom. I had Raynaud's. I have Raynaud's syndrome, which is a circulatory thing, but potentially autoimmune. And supposedly that's maybe a sign of it. But some people will have sleep troubles. A lot of times it might mimic like narcolepsy and how it disrupts your brain patterns. Mm-hmm. They diagnosed me with narcolepsy at one point in time. What else?
Just so many, 100 you say.
It's very difficult. And so like I had more neurological too, whereas if it's in my head, I feel like it was in here, in this part of my head. But some people have a lot more physical pain.
Right. Well, that's what my friend said. His knees, his
their
elbows,
joints.
His joints.
Mm-hmm. So I say to myself, which is better? Do I want to not be able to talk and remember things?
Right.
Or do I want my body to hurt? I don't think I really want either. So I've seen it manifest in many ways in people.
Mucha persona pues sufren de enfermedades. No puede dormir. Tiene ronchas en el cuerpo. No tienes ganas de hacer nada, estás cansado, te dan fiebres. Y son, se esconde. Dicen que es la enfermedad que se esconde porque nadie lo puede conseguir. And how long did you have, did you aware of that you had this? How long do you think before they diagnosed that you had?
7 years. 6 to 7 years.
7 años con la enfermedad, y en 7 años a él le hicieron todos los exámenes. Déjame decirle que su papá es un doctor. Y en estos 7 años no podían conseguir qué era lo que le estaba haciendo el daño a ella, pero durante este tiempo le estaba dando complicación con el cerebro, le daba fiebre, le daba dolor, los ojos, el oído, no podía oír en un lado. son tantas síntomas que usted puede tener. My question then is, with all these symptoms, and my concern is, a lot of people in different communities, no insurance.
Yeah.
My scary part is that somebody right now is watching and is saying, you know what? You're just talking about everything that they haven't diagnosed, and they're saying this. Let me go check. What's going to happen when they go check with their insurance?
Well, okay. So in my case, when I went to my family doctor, like a new doctor, I'd asked for recommendations to another place because I wasn't getting
any
answers.
And that's my next question. How can you test for the disease? And
I went to this place that I was referred to. Mm-hmm. I told this lady all of my symptoms. I was there for about 2 hours. I was a hot mess. Oh, I cried a lot too. And it does mess with your emotions.
Sentimental, emotional.
It can just distress your brain so much that that's part of another symptom.
Right.
But 2 hours she spent with me, I demanded to be tested for a million things because it's been 6 or 7 years now
you're
that
pissed.
I've researched
you
and I, yeah, it's like I've had enough. I'm mm-hmm. a danger to other people now driving, like whatever, I can't, this is terrible.
Sure, it does.
So she had told me she already diagnosed 9 people that week with Lyme disease and it was a Wednesday morning. So I got the standard testing. It's a 2-tier testing. You get they screen you basically for 10 bands of Lyme.
Is this blood test?
Mm-hmm.
Blood
yes,
test.
Yes,
okay.
I went and got blood work done. They do the ELISA test and then the Western blot. And that's going to, again, screen you for 10 common kinds. I don't even know if common is a good word. 10 types out of maybe 100 kinds of Lyme. So thankfully for me, my testing came back positive to the bands that are screened for.
Wow.
Because if not, I don't know if I'd still be here to talk to you about this.
Right, we talked about this.
But that was the best step to go forward, is to find a doctor who believes in Lyme, first of all,
right.
and who's willing to help you to get the testing. So that testing goes through insurance, no big deal.
Right.
It's the treatment that's not.
When you're diagnosed with Lyme, the treatment is expensive?
Yes, it's not covered by insurance. Like, so antibiotics thankfully have been, because the one is like $600 a month. My copay is, you know, $15, thank you God. But the other things that I do, because there's no standard procedure, no standard cure. Everybody's bodies deal with things differently. And so I've taken a more of a complete approach where mm-hmm. I will do a lot of herbal cares,
right.
like supplements, vitamins, gotcha. Things like that. Probably yeah. spend $500 a month on that
wow.
stuff. Going to see a Lyme specialist, because every disease, every, you know, thing that can go wrong with man, we have a specialist. So it makes sense that we have a Lyme specialist
right.
as well. Because regular doctors, God bless, they'll do their due diligence the best that they can, but mm-hmm. you need to see someone who speaks the language of Lyme
right.
to really help you.
You just can't go to any doctor. You have to go to a doctor that knows.
Yes.
I bet doctors you went to just like brushed you off, like she's just
most of the time they told me I was too stressed. And so, like, no offense, but a lot of them were male doctors. And there is this thought, too, that they look at it as a gender bias. But
sure. Oh,
I cried a lot, again, because I was so tired and I was begging for somebody to help me. So I could see that I might look like an overly emotional person.
Well, but 7 years with the disease, I would be emotional, too.
Yeah.
I'd probably be jumping all over the place.
Kind of what happens after. Well, I went to doctors for 4 years, and then I just gave up, and I dealt with it on my own for 3, which was sort of stupid of me. But I, after so long of being told you're fine and healthy and you're just too stressed, what do you do? And then you don't talk to people about it anymore either, because you're embarrassed.
Sure.
And you feel like there's something wrong with
you
as
psychologically,
correct.
Physically.
I went to a therapist. I tried a million different things to figure out what was happening to my body. And it just, no matter what happened, it didn't know, like no one could tell me the name of what plagued me. So.
Está hablando con ella. Yo sé que mucho, la razón que hago esto en español para esas personas que no entienden, porque esto es una enfermedad tan, tan mala. Ellos pueden hacerte el examen y el seguro cubre el examen. El examen es sangre y buscan por 10 tipos en la sangre para Lyme disease, porque hay diferentes. Otra vez, si usted cree que tiene Lyme disease, va y saque esa sangre. El problema que él me dice es que después que te sacan sangre, es que algunos seguros no cubren el tratamiento y pues es algo que tenemos que luchar y algo que ella está luchando en el Senado del estado de Pensilvania para ver si hace una ley para poder empezar a pagar esto. Pero si tú crees que tú tienes el Lyme disease, debe ir a su doctor y pedir la sangre.
And I just wanted to say too, thinking about it, when you do get tested, they're looking for antibodies in your blood, which is very difficult sometimes for them to detect those initially, or even later on, because it's not a high enough response that your body's making towards it. So it's hard to detect it. If you happen to get bit by a tick, you have the fortune to find it on your body.
Right.
Remove the tick as carefully as possible. Correct. Put it into a Ziploc baggie with a moist cotton ball. Put that in the freezer, because if you start to feel funky in a couple weeks, they can screen that, test that tick a lot easier than they can test for pupil.
Si usted, una de las otras maneras de saber que tienes el Lyme disease, tiene una garrapata pegada a tu cuerpo, Anne recomienda que busque una bolsita con un cantito de adobo y ponga un poquito de agua para que se mantenga un poquito mojado, y coja la garrapata y pone una bolsita plástica para que cuando vaya al doctor puedan chequear esa garrapata, porque en chequeando esa garrapata pequeñita ahí pueden determinar si tú tienes la enfermedad de Lyme. Eso es bien importante. Si la consigues, mucha gente se van a friquear, yo lo sé, pero yo sé si yo consigo no me vuelvo loco, pero tienes que guardarle una bolsita y ponerla en el freezer para que lo puedan chequear. How long will this stay in your body? Forever.
Probably. Even like they say when people are in remission.
He told me that.
Remission.
He said that he's remission, but then it eventually attacks you and it comes back.
Not necessarily always, but people who went into remission, when they pass away and they do an autopsy, they'll still find the bacteria in like their eyes or their joints, because what happens is it's a corkscrew-shaped organism that burrows into the white matter of your body after a long period of time. So your cartilage, collagen, your brain. And these are places oxygen doesn't readily penetrate, and subsequently neither do antibiotics. So it's really hard to get it out of those spaces once it gets to that point. So again, if you catch it initially, it's still in your bloodstream, you have a very good chance of just going on with your life and having no problems. But if it's left there for a very long time, then again, that's the matter of life.
So what percentage that are going to suffer from that?
Yeah, it's just really in every ounce of your being, and you have to just fight very hard to get to come out, like superhero strength.
We talked about treatment. What are the cures? I mean, we talked about this now. I mean, that means you're going to live with it. It's in your system for the rest of your life. Not in the whole percentage, but there, eventually some people will have it for the rest of their life. And speaking with my friend, he told me, we talked about mountain biking, and he had it for several years before they diagnosed it, but he says it hasn't gone away. He says that medication helps, but symptoms will come back eventually.
Yeah. I mean, I've changed my whole life. So I, like you, I don't drink alcohol.
Yeah.
I don't eat dairy, gluten, or sugar.
Wow.
I'm on a keto diet.
You work out like crazy.
I do Bikram yoga 5 days a week, Monday through Friday, 6 a.m. for 90 minutes to sweat as much as possible. I dry brush, which is a way to get your lymphatic system moving. I drink a ton of lemon water. That's a great way to detox. That's another thing, detoxification in and of itself that I do. Meditation. I take a ton of herbal supplements and vitamins. I go see a special doctor for this, you know, like, so there's just a million ways I feel that you can hit it from all sides. Like, it's not just one thing. It's every little bit to me that adds up to equal it. And I don't know, people ask me, do you have to do this for the rest of your life? I'm not sure, but I understand what it feels like to be sick, and I will subsequently do what I need to do to remain from going back into that space. I can't handle that.
So I'm going to ask you a question, and with all due respect. So I'd like to know what all those people that made you feel so bad, thinking that you had other issues, and now the truth comes out. Because I, you know, seeing and speaking with you, I can see after 7 years, people think, well, she's crazy. she's got issues. And now that they know that you were ill with Lyme disease, I'm just curious with those people that thought,
it's kind of funny, actually. So one of the people that initially was trying to help figure out what was going on with me, he helped me do like allergy testing, every other test known to man. He worked at one place. And then years later, I went to a dermatologist because I had perioral dermatitis from being on antibiotics for too long. And lo and behold, in walks this person. And I was like, I didn't know if I should be sad, angry, happy. And I was like, by the way, this is what's wrong with me. And pretty much all the color drained out of his face. His wife is an infectious disease doctor, which that whole thing is questionable in how they view Lyme anyways. But she would know, and he is in the medical, he knew exactly, and he felt horrible. He could just see it. And, you know, but you can't go back. I can't change right. what's happened to me. I can only move right. forward and try to help other people avoid
sure.
the same disaster. But I thought many times to go back and see some of the other doctors that sat there and just told me there was nothing wrong with me and made wow. me feel like I even tried to sell my house. I was doing everything I could just to make life work for me. And gratefully, I still have my home. I'm still here breathing air on this right. earth. And I don't know.
Helping now.
Yeah.
Become an advocate.
Yeah.
I went into websites, and a lot of them are in Spanish.
Oh, good.
I found some in Spanish.
Good.
It's a good idea to go into the web. Is that one of your ideas? What is a way to get more information about? Would it be going in there, or what are your suggestions?
My parent organization, so again, I'm the regional director for Berks County Lyme Support mm-hmm. Group. I started that, I launched it in April.
So somebody can speak in, somewhere where they can call and speak to somebody in Spanish, or is that not available now? Would that
That's
be something?
That's a great question. I'm sure we would be able to figure out a resource
to help.
For it. But so I'm the, like, there's 20 other regions of PA Lyme
okay.
in our state, which is wonderful. But you can look at my parent organization website, PALyme.org, and they have a ton of information there. They would be able to give you a physician referral if you're looking for a Lyme specialist, and they're all physicians that have been vetted, tried and true, that they really can speak the language of Lyme. Mm-hmm. You want to look for an ILADS physician. It's an International Lyme and Associated Disease Society trained physician. But that's a great resource. The web, generally speaking, you're going to educate yourself pretty
right,
well. Twitter has been a great tool for me to keep a pulse on what's going on currently. But you know, you're going to read different sides of the coin. Some
right.
people believe in Lyme, some people don't. Some people
right.
think this is nothing. And I can tell you from my own personal experience that it's something that can completely change your life. Not necessarily for the better.
I want to... Si una persona de afuera cree que usted tiene esta enfermedad, el Lyme disease, otra vez una garrapata que te pica y la enfermedad, y la razón que tengo este programa es porque muchas personas sufren de la enfermedad y no lo saben. Ustedes pueden ir a su computadora, es PALYME.org. Ahí usted puede conseguir más información. Sobre todo, if they think they got Lyme, I think the first step would be call your family doctor.
Correct.
Call your family. Si usted cree que usted tiene esta enfermedad con todo lo que nosotros hablamos, que tú has tenido una enfermedad por mucho tiempo, un sentido de catarro, un dolor en algún lado, los doctores te dicen que te estás inventando ya, mi recomendación para ustedes es que vayan a su doctor familiar y le diga que te hagan el examen de Lyme disease, porque hay mucho, yo creo que hay muchas personas allá afuera que tienen eso. Any last words for the community?
If you do happen to get diagnosed with it, mm-hmm. make sure you also get screened for co-infections, because that's something that's not talked about enough.
Co-infections.
But like a lot of times, I was talking to a biologist, 65% or 70% of the ticks she studies have more than one illness that you can be infected with, and people don't understand that part. It's like, oh, Lyme, but no, you have these other
There's
things
other
you
things
need to look for. If you don't cure, like if you don't treat those,
Whole
your body
thing.
Never will really heal.
Come back. Algo que dice Anne, que si usted tiene la enfermedad, es bien importante que pase, haga todas las cosas que son requeridas para hacer, regla esta enfermedad, porque esta enfermedad puede seguir y es tan importante que busquen a alguien que te haga la sangre. Si lo tiene, durante ese proceso que te están sacando sangre, por favor pídanle que te hagan todo el examen completo. Son 10 diferentes exámenes en la sangre. Dile a tu doctor que te hagan todas esas.
Can you say quick prevention by chance?
Yes.
Like to make sure to
Para evitar que no lo cojas.
Treat with, like, put your permethrin on your clothing and your
uh-huh.
shoes.
I'm going to have a good idea saying what that is in Spanish, but
insecticide.
Insect repellent.
Called Sawyers.
Sawyers.
You can get it at Dick's.
Sawyers. So, recomiendo que vayan a una tienda donde venden cosas para evitar que te piquen los mosquitos, te piquen diferentes animalitos. Eso es lo primero. Second thing you talk to me about is if you go out in the woods... Mm. Is to wrap tape around.
I mean, tuck your pants into your socks.
Ponga los pantalones adentro. Esto
clothes.
Si tú estás en el pasco jugando afuera, donde hay árboles, donde sus niños están afuera en su patio, y es cerca de un árbol. Pónganse los pantalones adentro de la gorra, camisa, tapando
yes,
su.
And light colored. So you can see ticks crawling on you.
Okay, colores claros cuando usted mueve las garrapatas caminando
mm-hmm.
en uno.
When you come inside, put your clothing in the dryer on high heat for 10 minutes.
Ponga la ropa en la secadora cuando entren.
Shower within 2 hours of being outdoors
Váyanse.
To rinse them off of you
mm-hmm.
and do daily tick checks.
Y que chequen que estén las garrapatas en su cuerpo. Thank you, Anne, so much for being here.
Thank you.
We need to do another one. It starts getting close to spring.
Yes.
Las gracias a todos ustedes por estar conmigo. Recuérdense, yo estoy con ustedes cada segundo miércoles del mes de 6:30 a 7. Ha llegado ya al fin mi programa Directo a la Comunidad. Las gracias a BCTV. Y pues nos vemos el mes de diciembre. Que las pasen bien, que pasen una acción de gracias muy especial. Que Dios los cuide a todos. Chao.
Directo a la Comunidad on BCTV is supported by UPMC for you.